Our castaway this week is an actor who has done some exceptionally good work on television and in films and in the theatre, John Hurt. John, how well could you adapt yourself mentally to a desert island existence?
I can't imagine the idea of going there and wanting to get off it, so therefore I think I would have to adapt pretty quickly, I think.
Would a modest supply of music help you?
I'm not by nature a tremendously musical person, but I suppose, yes, a modicum of music would help.
Have you any musical talent? Do you sing or play an instrument?
I like to think that I sing, but nobody else agrees.
Have you sung in public? In a performance?
I've only sung in one performance, and it took me 22 years to get to that, and that was The Fool in Lear that I did with Sir Lawrence.
Yes.
And they had very, very simple little songs, but it took me a full month to get those right.
Did you have any plan in choosing your 8 records?
Yes, I did. I thought, well, there are many ways of looking at this, and I decided that the way I'd approach it was to pinpoint parts of my life. That's all, things that remind me of a particular area of my life.
Where do we start?
Well, we start at St. Martin's School of Art, really, circa 1959, with Lead Belly.
What's he singing?
Backwater Blues.
And it rained 5 days and the skies turned dark as night. And the trouble taking place in the lowland that night.
Huddy Ledbetter, Backwater Blues. By ancestry, John, you're a Celt. Is that right?
Basically, yes.
Where were you born?
I was born in Derbyshire.
And your father is a parson?
My father is a Church of England clergyman.
And you have a brother who became a monk?
Yes, I have a brother. He was a convert to Catholicism when he was at Cambridge University, and he later became a monk, was at Downside for some dozen years, I think. And then, as far as I can remember, he jumped over the wall and married someone who was, I think, about to become a nun, but obviously didn't. Mm. That didn't work out too well, so there was a divorce somehow, and he is now married extremely happily, I'm delighted to say, with 3 children.
Now, what else can we talk about in your early days? You were a leader of the Wolf Cubs.
Where did you dig that out? Yes, for my father, yes, he was pretty short-staffed. When I was 16 years old, I ran a cub pack in Cleethorpes, or New Clee, which is between Grimsby and Cleethorpes, mm-hmm. Sort of no-man's land. And I had a very considerable-sized pack. I had 30 boys in it, real rough lads they were as well. Terrific.
Covered with badges?
No badges at all. That's the interesting thing. I had 30 boys and we all had a terrific time. But on St. George's Day Parade in Grimsby, for instance, there'd be several packs there of all the various different churches and boys' organisations and so on. And they were covered in badges, but they only had about 6 boys in each pack.
Uh-huh.
Whereas I had 30 boys strong in mine, but I'm afraid I didn't get round to doing many badges.
Where did you go to school?
I was at a prep school in Kent called St. Michael's School, Hotford Court, near Sevenoaks in Kent. And having failed my common entrance to go to the public school that I was supposed to go to, I don't know whether that was intentional or not, to follow my brother to St. John's Leatherhead. I failed it 3 times because I couldn't pass mathematics, much to my father's chagrin, who was a double first in maths at the age of 20. Unfortunately, I never made more than 15%. In fact, I was rather delighted when I made 15% because at least I got into double figures, but it didn't please him very much.
Mm-hmm.
However, they managed to get me into a school called Lincoln School at the time. I think it's now a comprehensive, but it was a grammar school with a boarding house of 40 boys, which was
bad at maths. What were you good at?
English. Always very high percentage in English.
At school, what did you want to be?
From the age of 9, I wanted to be an actor. Really, from the first time that I went onto a stage. I don't think I ever thought there was such a thing as a professional actor, or if I did, I didn't know what it meant.
There was a good repertory theatre in Lincoln. Did you get to see it?
Yes, indeed, when I was at Lincoln School, and it was at Lincoln Rep that I applied before I got the result from the Royal Academy as to whether I got in or not.
Mm.
And I applied to them because I'd been at Lincoln School and asked them if they got any kind of a job, and they very kindly gave me a dog's body job as a sort of assistant stage manager. And paid me £6 a week.
When was this? Was this immediately after you left school?
No, I left school in 1957, I think it was, and I was at Grimsby School of Art for 2 years, and then in 1959 I went to St. Martin's School of Art.
So really, acting was the second choice? You wanted to paint?
No, acting was the first choice, but my parents strongly believed that I should have something to fall back on, as it were, and those were the days when one was obliged to take notice of your parents. And the other thing that I was particularly interested in was painting, as I was not interested in an academic career.
Did you start to paint at that time?
I'd always enjoyed painting through the always inadequate art classes that one had at that time in various schools that I was at. And also Stephen Shepherd, who used to teach me when I was at my prep school, had remained a friend. He interested me and got me extremely interested in painting itself, though I'd never really taken it seriously until I went to art school. And in many ways, I'm very glad I did it, because it created an interest which I never lost.
Let's have your second record. What's that to be?
This is Grimsby School of Art period. It's slightly later than the Leadbelly one. Through a girl who was at that time training to be a concert pianist, called Priscilla Jessop, I remember. She put me onto this, and I've loved it ever since. And it's the Brahms Second Piano Concerto with Sviatoslav Richter playing.
An excerpt from the Brahms Second Piano Concerto with Sviatoslav Richter as soloist and the Chicago Symphony Orchestra conducted by Erich Leinsdorf. After Lincoln, you went to the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art.
That's right, yes, I did, 1960.
What was your first job when you left?
I did actually do a television for Herbert Wise right in the middle of the training period.
That's against the rules, isn't it?
Well, no, it was allowed. Yes, applications were made and I was allowed to do it in the vacation. It was the fourth lead in the television, and I got £65 for it.
And when you left?
When I left, I tested for a film and got the part. It was called The Wild and the Willing. Nobody ever came up with any reasonable explanation as to who was wild and who was willing. But it was based on a play called The Tinker, which is about a red brick university.
Oh, I remember.
And
that.
It was directed by Ralph Thomas, whose son I have worked with twice, who is now a well-known producer, as we all know.
You went into Chips with Everything, that RAF play that had a lot of parts for young actors.
I did. I took over in Chips with Everything in 1962. It's during that time, actually, that I got married between a matinee and an evening performance.
Well, you don't want to waste any time.
No, not really. The marriage, I'm afraid, finished almost as quickly.
Oh, dear.
But never mind. We had a crack at it.
I remember seeing you in a flop at the Garrick. It only lasted 2 or 3 weeks, but I was very impressed. It was about an art school.
That's right. It was written by David Halliwell, called Little Malcolm and His Struggle Against the Eunuchs.
That's
which is
right.
Now actually a very well-known play. Mm. And a wonderful play it is, too.
Yes, you had a very good part in that.
Well, Little Malcolm, yes. They were all wonderful parts in that. It's very sad, actually, that, because, as I remember, the house full notices were up for the last 3 performances, but by that time the notices had gone up and we were finishing anyway.
You were learning the hard way.
Yes, indeed.
Your third record, please.
Well, the third record actually comes from about that period, because we did Little Malcolm in Dublin to begin with, before we came to the Garrick at the Dublin Festival. And it was there that I met my friend Gareth Brown, who introduced me to Irish music, which I've been very fond of ever since. And I met a certain Dolly McMahon, and this is one of her songs from her, as far as I know, her only LP, called Dolly.
What's the song called?
The song's called Love is Teasing.
I wish I were a maid again, but a maid again I can never be, until apples grow on an ivy tree. And love is teasing, and love is a treasure when first it's new.
Dolly McMahon, Love is Teasing. When did you do the film version of A Man for All Seasons? That must have been a rewarding job.
It was very rewarding. It wasn't very rewarding for David Warner, because unfortunately he couldn't get out of Hamlet, otherwise he would have played the part. But fortunately, during that 3.5 weeks of Little Malcolm, Fred Zinnemann saw the play and asked to see me and gave me the job. That was the first international film that I'd been in, mm-hmm. And that was in 1966.
Richard!
I fell. Lady Alice. Lady Margaret.
Good evening.
Do you know William Roper the Younger?
By reputation, of course.
Good evening, Master...
Rich.
Oh,
you've heard of me?
Yes.
In what connection? I don't know what you can have heard.
I sense that I'm not welcome here.
Why, Richard, have you done something to make you not welcome?
Cromwell is asking questions about you. He's continually asking questions about you and your opinions.
Of whom?
Of him? Of what? That's one of his sources.
Of course, that's one of my servants.
You look at me as though I were an enemy.
Why, Richard, you're shaking.
Help me.
How?
Employ me.
No.
Employ me.
No.
I would be faithful.
Richard, you couldn't answer for yourself even so far as tonight.
Thank you.
film part which won you a lot of praise and kudos was 10 Rillington Place.
Well, that was a wonderful part. I thought that was the ultimate in victims that I was ever going to play, I thought.
This was about the celebrated murder.
Well, it was about the wrongful hanging of Timothy Evans, in fact.
And yes. You played the unfortunate Evans.
I did, yeah. And Richard Attenborough played Christie.
You had a distinguished technical advisor.
Yes, we did indeed have a very distinguished technical advisor who came under a pseudonym. I can't remember what his pseudonym was. But he did turn out to be, in fact, Albert Pierpoint, who was, for those who don't know, the last hangman of England. He had some interesting observations to make when asked. I remember Richard Fleischer, who directed it, when we'd done the hanging scene, which was the first time that it had ever been shown as it was, because until that time it had been under the Official Secrets Act.
That must have been an awful sequence to do.
It really was a very, very creepy sequence to do indeed. And I remember a couple of secretaries had to leave the floor in order to, well, to be sick, really. It was a very creepy sequence indeed, I must say. Mm. But, I mean, when Fleischer said to him, well, thank you very much, he said, for all your technical help and so on, he said, oh, no, not at all, he said. It's been years.
Oh, no.
Which didn't add, you know. And think of the other remarks he said. I remember that the noose was hanging, tied by a little piece of cotton with three loops in it. Mm. And at that particular angle, it was slightly in the way of the shot that Fleischer wanted in. He said, will it be in the way when we come to do the shot? And he said, oh, no, 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 he said, I just want the lads to get the hang of it, that's all. So there were some very not-too-good puns flying around that day.
You had this technical advisor on that film, but you're not, I'm told, an actor who worries very much about historical accuracy and authenticity. You like to build up a character from your own impression, is that right?
Well, I wouldn't say that exactly. I like to work from the script.
Yes.
Generally speaking, the writer has done a great deal of research, and if he is a good dramatic writer, he's written in such a way that it is intended for the imagination to take over. I don't personally find that by reading a lot of books about a character that it in fact helps to make the imagination fly. Mm. This is entirely my way of working, and I find it works for me.
Leave all that sort of stuff to the writer.
Indeed I do, yes. And if it isn't well written, well, I wouldn't do the part anyway, so...
Your fourth record.
This is my attempt to get to know opera, really, which wasn't very successful because, being as I like the storyline and I like the lyrics and so on, the big trouble I find with opera is that they're so utterly ludicrous. However, in this effort, I did come across one piece that I adore, and I've chosen the final aria. It was Joan Sutherland singing from La Traviata.
Joan Sutherland singing Violetta's last aria from La Traviata, Addio del Passato. Thank you. Let's pick out a few more highlights from your career, Don. A challenging part was the television portrayal of Quentin Crisp in The Naked Civil Servant. Did you meet Mr. Crisp?
Yes, I did, indeed. I asked Mr. Crisp if he'd like to have lunch on Sunday, one particular Sunday, which he accepted. I remember offering him a Guinness, which I knew was the drink that he drank, which he indeed took. I offered him another, and he had that. I offered him a third later in the afternoon, and he said, no, I couldn't, any more would be a debauch.
That's a nice line.
But again, having met him and talked about anything, really, I mean, nothing specific, I didn't see a great deal more of him.
You didn't attempt an accurate impersonation?
Not an accurate impersonation, no. People think that it is. I mean, many people have been kind enough to say that it's exactly the same. It isn't at all exactly the same, as Quentin will quite readily tell you. Mm-hmm. But I hope it is evocative of him. I mean, I hope it has the feeling that I wanted to make of him. And being as we were doing a rough look-alike, but anyway, we were taking the hair the same way, the costume the same way, and the walk much the same kind of way, because it was too rich not to use. But the secret, really, with Quentin on that Sunday, I discovered, is that he knows what he's going to say, when he's going to say it, and how he's going to say it, which is an absolute gift in terms of drama, because it means you don't have to pause at all, because you're thinking all the time the other person is speaking. So you come straight in, because he knows exactly how he's going to say what he's going to say and when.
Playing a homosexual can be dangerous for an actor. Did you find that people thought this must be for real?
I've been asked, yes. They said, you know, John, are you in fact, you know, one of them? And I say, well, God, if I was one of them, I would have had a lot less trouble in my life, I can tell you. But I don't think so, really, because I remember Robert Bolt wrote me a letter afterwards saying that after the initial shock of the subject matter in the first 5 minutes, it became a story about the tenderness of the individual versus the cruelty of the crowd. And I think that's basically what people got from it, yeah, rather than an essay on homosexuality, which I don't think it was anyway.
Right, number five.
Fifth record. Well, I mean, this is an inevitability in a way. And I chose this one because, I mean, it was the period of the Beatles. Had to be. I mean, the whole of the 60s was an extraordinary decade, and even though I stood somewhat outside of it in terms of the psychedelic experience of the 60s, was not really my scene, but there was a lot that went with it, so I have to include the Beatles. But I'm delighted to choose this one because actually I was there when it was being, part of it was being made.
In Abbey Road?
Yeah. And the one I've chosen is Hey Jude.
Hey Jude, don't be afraid.
Show.
Now, The Alien, I think, was the next of your successful films, wasn't it?
Alien came by mistake, as a matter of fact.
Did it?
Yes, rather pleasant mistake. I was supposed to go to South Africa to make a film called Zulu Dawn. And 5 minutes before I was to get into the taxi to go to London Airport, the telephone went and said, you better not get into the taxi because you're not going to be able to get into South Africa when you get there anyway. They're not going to let you in.
Oh.
So I said, well, that's very odd. Why not? And nobody ever knows, being as it is a totalitarian state, virtually. They're not obliged to tell us why not. But through, I think it's Janet Sussman's aunt, who is something of a thorn in the side of the South African government, and she is an MP there, I believe, did do quite a lot to try and find out what it was, and we think it was probably mistaken identity of some sort. And I got a letter back eventually saying that if I ever applied to go there again, it would be viewed in a different light.
Well, that's encouraging, but you had lost that job.
I can't say that I particularly want to go there. But the thing is, by losing that job, the next week, Ridley Scott came round to my house because an actor was unable to take the part. And he left my house, I think, at 12:30, half an hour past midnight, and I was on the set at 7 o'clock in the morning.
In what sort of makeup?
Well, hair was quickly cut. I was quickly briefed as to what the gang was about, met them, and started that morning.
And then we get to the Elephant Man. That must have been a very uncomfortable makeup with all that gear all over you, make it made up as that hideously deformed man.
Yes, it was. There's no question of that. It was a long and tedious makeup. It was a 7-hour makeup, in actual fact. I think we did 22, all told. Started at 5 o'clock in the morning, and we finished at noon, and we shot through till 10:30 at night.
Could you eat and drink when you're going?
No, I couldn't. My last meal was at 9 o'clock in the morning, which was 2 raw eggs with orange juice, which I managed to suck between my gum.
Thank you.
Record number 6.
Well, I'm going to go back to Ireland again, as I frequently go back to Ireland. This is a record, actually, that I'd recently given for my birthday. And it's off an album called Tin Whistles. And the whistles are played by my friend Paddy Maloney of the Chieftains. And Sean Potts is also of the Chieftains and is their main whistler. And it's a love song.
Paddy Maloney playing an Irish love song. Now, this is very much John Hurt year, isn't it? 4 of your films are being released and you've got married. Now, that's quite a lot to happen within 12 months.
It is indeed. I'm just hoping that it's not going to be too sparse a year next year.
Well, let's talk about the films. Champions. You played Bob Champion, the jockey who, despite being seriously ill with cancer, won the Grand National. In this case, you had Bob Champion with you on the set most of the time, didn't you?
We did quite a lot of the time, yes. Bob was a technical advisor on the film. But I managed not to be with him too much, because rather, in the same sense as when I was playing Quentin Crisp, I prefer to work out of the imagination than I do to work as a kind of imitation.
And, of course, you're a horseman, so you did a lot of the riding yourself.
Wouldn't say that I was a horseman, and not to anybody in the horse world. I do ride a horse, but there's a slight difference there. But I did train to ride as a jockey for that, with Terry Biddlecombe. And it's very exciting. In fact, I can't think of a better way of riding a horse now. Not that I have done since.
Thank you. Now, the hit, which has had exceedingly good notices, that's a rather serious, tough film, isn't it?
Well, I wouldn't say that it's entirely... I mean, it is a serious film, but it is not a serious film without jokes. I don't like the word black comedy because it always puts me off, and I think it puts a lot of other people off, but it is comedy that comes out of the humanity of the four people and their journey through Spain. Basically, it's about a what is now called a supergrass, who managed to get himself to Spain, so long as he gave away certain names, which he did. Then the major part of the film starts 10 years later, and my character arrives to collect Terence Stamp, who is playing the other character, with my sidekick, Tim Roth. And basically the story is a journey of extracting him from Cordoba, or near Cordoba, where he's staying, and they go right up through the middle of Spain, through Madrid, where they have another encounter with another criminal and so on. And finally they get up to the Basque Country, and the whole thing is gone wrong many times. Mm. Further than that, I'm not really going to say.
And Osterman Weekend?
Osterman Weekend is a film that I made just before Champions in America with the dangerous Sam Peckinpah, who actually wasn't being as dangerous as he has been in the past, at any rate. But a chaotic film, in a way. That's a pure entertainment, in a sense. Mm-hmm. But I think somebody got a bit lost with the storyline in it.
What do you play?
A rather deranged CIA man who is getting his own back at the CIA and goes off the rails somewhat.
And, of course, 1984, which we haven't seen yet, which is... Well, we know the story. It's a great story. And, of course, it's a film that we shall see with a certain amount of sadness.
Well, that's true in regard to what happened to Richard Burton, that is.
Yes.
I think it's one of his best film performances. Now, he's making a film, in fact, in Geneva when he died. And he lives in Seligny, which is a small village about 25 minutes outside there. And I had dinner with him on Friday night and stayed over in his little guest chalet. It's a very modest house, it was, too. He said it was a modest house when he was working on 1984, but I didn't believe it. But it was, actually, a very modest house. And, as indeed, Richard was not the sort of person that everybody thinks he was. He wasn't the great swashbuckler. He was a very sensitive, extremely well-read, interesting man, who, obviously, during his life, had his moments, I don't mean...
Oh, yeah.
We ate on the Friday night, and I stayed over and was talking to him all Saturday morning, and on the Sunday, Sally Burton rang me up and said, could you come over immediately? Because Richard is dead.
Oh, no.
And, it came as a terrific shock to everyone,
yes.
I think.
One of the last friends he saw.
It would seem so,
yeah.
And he was a very new friend to me.
Mm-hmm. Which parts do you and Richard Burton play? Who plays Winston Smith?
I play Winston Smith, and Richard played O'Brien,
mm-hmm.
who is his captor, really.
...1984 was very much a quick idea, wasn't it? That the idea of remaking it, you went more or less straight in.
Well, the idea was casual, you might say, because Simon Perry was talking to Michael Radford, the director, in a wine bar, wondering what they were going to do next after Another Time, Another Place. And Radford said, well, I've always wanted to make 1984, but I suppose somebody's made it. And Simon said, well, I don't think anybody has, you know. So he said, I'll look into it. He looked into it and found out that nobody was making it. Then he found out where the rights were, and then introduced themselves by letter to Marvin Rosenblum, who was in Chicago. And he loved the film that they'd already made, and he said, I'll come into the production with the rights free and so on, if you can find the money and write the script by Christmas. Now, this was only October of last year. And by Christmas, they'd found the money, they'd written the script, which I might say was eminently shootable in its first draft. And we were shooting the end of February.
Yes.
And it was on October the 12th it opens.
What was your shooting schedule? Was it a long film?
It was, in all, 14 weeks, I think it was. But, I mean, you have to remember that when you're making 1984, you're making two films, because so much of it is constantly in the background on the telescreens, that all that has to be shot first before you start the actual story.
Yes.
So it's two films in one.
Where was most of it done?
The studio work was all done at Twickenham Studios, and a little bit at Shepperton, and The Golden Country was shot in Wiltshire.
Well, let's have your seventh record, John. What's that?
This is a record by a friend of mine. I'd hate to leave him out, and he'd be very annoyed with me if I did, anyway. And it's by Eric Clapton, and I'd like to dedicate this to my wife. It's Wonderful Tonight.
She puts on her makeup, and brushes her long blonde hair.
Eric Clapton, Wonderful Tonight. John, you're on this desert island. Have you got some ideas on how you're going to manage? Could you look after yourself? Could you rig up a shelter? You were a leader of the Wolf Cubs.
I was an arcaler of the Wolf Cubs, but I mean, like many of my generation, I was a Boy Scout before that, and, you know, my father's very keen scouting man. Sure, I could make clay ovens and cook in those, and I can make fire from twigs and things. I mean, as long as there's a couple of trees on this here island.
Well, what are you going to cook? Can you fish?
I can fish, yes.
You can?
I fish to a certain extent. Yeah, it depends on what I'm fishing for. I've done a bit of fishing.
How are you in a small boat? And could you build one?
I think if I grew my fingernails and clawed at a log for long enough, I could make some sort of a coracle.
Can you navigate a coracle?
I've never tried.
I mean, you know which is north and which is south.
Oh, I know which is east and which is west as well.
You do?
Oh, yes, that's the end of Heaven's Gate. How does it go?
They taught you to navigate in Heaven's
Gate. The sun will continue to set in the west. The majority of us considered it best. So.
You've obviously given some thought to the subject, even if a scriptwriter's mind was working on it.
Well, yes, I'd prefer to go there with a script, I must say.
Thank you.
Let's have your eighth record.
Well, I'm going to finish on Mozart, because I rather suspect that this is one record that you could probably never tire of. And it's the Piano Concerto No. 21 by Mozart, and it is played by Vladimir Ashkenazy.
Part of the third movement of Mozart's Piano Concerto No. 21 in C major, Vladimir Ashkenazy with the Philharmonia Orchestra. John, if you could take only one disc out of the eight that you've chosen and played us, which would it be?
I think that's a very unfair question. However, if I could only take one, I would take the whistle music, the Irish whistle music.
And one luxury to take with you, any one object that would give you pleasure to have, but is of no practical use.
I thought of taking a high-heeled shoe, just to remind me of certain things that I wasn't going to be able to have. But then I thought, that might be a very frustrating thing to take. So in the end, I thought, well, let's go for total selfishness. And I thought, well, of all the things, I'm not a luxury-minded person, but the one thing I think I probably would miss would be a pillow.
Mm-hmm.
So I take a pillow.
And one book you already have, with the complete works of Shakespeare and the Holy Bible. You may have one other volume.
Now, this is a tricky one. This is a tricky one. I thought of taking Fowler's English Usage.
Yes.
Because it's an immensely witty book. On the other hand, I thought, well, perhaps if I'm going to be on a desert island, you really need something which is going to feed the imagination more than anything else. And the books that I've had more joy from than anything else have been, in that area, Lewis Carroll. So I'd probably take the complete works of Lewis Carroll, if I'm allowed to do that. It's all in one volume.
Yes, indeed, you may have that. And thank you, John Hurt, for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.
Thank you for letting me play them.
Goodbye, everyone.